Hello everyone, this is Bobbin Threadbare, and welcome back to the previous map. See, these guys in the outbuilding here, they have something to say. They're such easy targets, I didn't give them the chance.
Why'd they change the codes?
Howard Strong. They want his group to have exclusive access to the silo.
Always trusting civilians. Look where that got us.
Page knows what he's doing.
My squad eliminated the dangerous employees.
Two words, New York City.
I'm not standing up for Simons. He was careless.
So Page, he hands over an entire operation to an opportunist like Howard Strong.
I would watch what I say, Bob Page.
No kidding. All things considered. So, another thing is that there are a couple of dead bodies that I forgot to look out for. One's actually on the other side of these crates here. See? Pistol and an accuracy weapon mod. Not really worth it for me to go back for this, but, you know, just so you know it's there. And then once you get back at the bottom here, underneath the elevator, you can find this guy. Which is good, because I used up a lot of bioenergy just going back for that last body. But we may now continue.
Page is further down. Find the elevator. Your primary objective is to kill Page, JC.
I'll be quiet. I have no idea what this triggers. But I figure it's better not to know.
Pleased to see one of my experiments perform so well. You aren't even afraid, are you? We got a lot of things right when we made you, Denton, but don't worry. I know your weaknesses.
Like that's gonna help.
How much further?
Not far. You will reach Page. I just wanted to let you know that Alex hacked the Sector 2 security grid. The code's 8946. And I wanted to warn you about Tracer Tong.
Tong's helping out from Vandenberg. The vaccine worked.
Yes, well, he has another motive. He wants you to destroy Area 51.
That's the plan.
No, JC. Spare the facility. Spare Helios the power station. They can be made to service.
Us?
You and me, JC. We'll rule the world in secret, with an invisible hand, the way the Illuminati have always ruled.
Don't you think it's time we end the tyranny for everyone?
There's such a thing as a compassionate conspiracy. We don't need Page's commandos, troopers, crude inventions. Trust me. Kill Page. Dowd and I will be here to help with the next step.
Interesting. Also, trapdoor. There's no way to bust it open, so I'm just gonna have to pick it. Now, what do we got here? Karkians. Just the little guys, though. Now, that's interesting. It's normally supposed to be a dead body over here. I guess those valves turn off steam vents that would have hampered my progress, but, well, you can't see them now. And I'm not actually going to use this tunnel. There's another way to get forward, and I'm going to take that. There's a lot of goodies in that direction. Robot. So, what was that number you said was on the security grid? There we go. So what have we got in here? Looks like crew rest quarters. Barracks. Also, something is making the combat music go off, and that's an infinite keypad. Interesting. Well, luckily, with just the flashlight, I can see what we would be buying by bypassing the keypad here. And also, it's not worth two tools, so I'm back to this old trick. All it is some buckshot and a lockpick. I didn't even need that cell. Nothing at all. Oh, that's why. Well, just a bio cell, and I definitely don't need an AUG canister. How about in here? Plasma, darts, and assault rifle ammo. I think I'm done in here. At least until I can find the code for that infinite keypad. No robot, but that camera is gonna be trouble. Luckily, it can't see through doors. Also, I kinda know what's in here already. Fortunately, WIBs are also vulnerable to WP rounds. Not much else here. Looks like a break room. Don't know why they put a dead body on the table tennis thing. But that's the code for that infinite keypad in the last room. Now I don't have to worry about the camera, so let's just head back nice and quick. It's just around the corner here. And here we go. What do we get? Yeah, cloak. I hardly even use it, but... well, if I do, it won't cost that much energy. I'm kind of curious, though. I mean, like, the MJ-12 troopers ran this facility in the first place, in conjunction with the Army and the Army scientists. So why have they come down here to slaughter all of the Army troopers? I guess it probably has something to do with that whole martial law thing. You know, Walton Simons declared martial law, and then according to the newspapers, not everybody in the Army has gone along with it. Like, whole sections of the upper brass have refused to impose martial law on the nation. Refused to allow Simons to usurp the power of the President and of Congress. It's actually kind of heartwarming, in a sense. I mean, yeah, they failed here, but this is the root of power for MJ-12, so... nuts. It's got Sabo. Now I have to figure a way to get over there. It's gonna be tough. Got a neat speed enhancement. I guess if there were some movable crates around here somewhere, I could try that, but without them, it's a little more difficult to find a way up. Maybe this will do. Huh. Well, it failed to work, but it worked anyway. Well, no complaints. I got up here where I wanted to be. Oh, yeah. And, that tunnel that I'm walking on right now... oh, hey there, buddy. Missed you. That tunnel I'm walking on, that's the one that connected to the one place by the holo projector. See? This is where you would come out. And over... yeah, over this way, there's a lamb on the wall. I don't even need it, I just, you know, wanted to prove it was there. There we go. Top me up. That's about it for section two, but... you know, there is one more thing. A certain weapon that I've been meaning to show off from the very beginning. Gonna need some room to pull it off, but, yeah, what the hell, I don't even use the pistol anymore. I'm picking up the assault rifle again, but not to show off the regular bullets. Regular bullets are still worthless. I mean, they do 4 damage instead of 3 now, ooh. But then there's this alt fire. That's the key we got in the infinite keypad room.
Do what you think's right, JC. Only listen to your own conscience.
But yeah, the alternate ammo is called 20mm HE rounds. If you're wondering what they are, I'm about to show you.
Bet you didn't know your mom and dad tried to protest when we put you in training. They love their little boy, JC, and that's why they're dead. I'm sending up the man who did the job.
It's a grenade launcher, and I can carry up to 30 grenades in this assault rifle.
Barely a scratch. You're a little faster on your feet than your daddy was.
They do a lot of damage, and man, I got blood everywhere. Holy crap. Who's gonna pop out of this one?
We can get you into Sector 3, but no further. Page is in a separate area with his own security grid.
Everett says you want me to destroy Area 51.
I intercepted his communication. JC, he is simply using you to bring the Illuminati back to power. Listen to Savage and me. There is a reactor lab with two antimatter reactors.
In other words, yes. You want me to blow the facility up. Why? It's just a hole in the ground.
Decades ago, the UN made Area 51 the central hub for all electronics communications. The Aquinas Protocol, originally for surveillance, has given Page unlimited abilities to censor and control all forms of media.
If we destroy the Aquinas hub, we'll take down the global network.
Exactly. They dug their own grave, JC. We're going to eliminate global communications altogether.
I don't know. Sounds like overkill.
As long as technology has a global reach, someone will have the world in the palm of his hand. If not Bob Page, then Everett, Dowd.
Another Stone Age would hardly be an improvement.
Not so drastic. A Dark Age. An age of city-states. Craftsmen. Government on a scale comprehensible to its citizens.
I'll think about it.
Savage has a map of Sector 3 from when he worked down there. I'm transmitting now. Use it to find your way to Page's complex in Sector 4. Then find the coolant control room, which should be at the northwest corner of Sector 4. Cut off the coolant to the reactors, then go to the reactor lab. I will tell you how to trigger an explosion.
Apparently nobody knows how to pronounce Aquinas. Well, that's the map. We just came out of here, so that's about where we're standing. Coolant filtration, there's the reactor, and it's... I guess that leads eventually to Aquinas itself.
A corpse, yes. You feel something. Let us know what you're feeling.
Okay. Let's hope I can take some of these guys down up here. Uh-oh. He's gonna be a tricky one. Damn it! Should have been a headshot. That should have been a headshot, because I got his arms instead. Oh, shit. Oh, shit. Wow. At least the troopers dealt with him. How about you? Coming down? Well, that was a bloody mess, but at least I'm alive, and well, and everything that is most dangerous is dead.
My own augmentations are nearly complete. Soon, I will be more powerful than you can imagine.
I know there's another spider bot down there somewhere. Oh, shit. Okay, are we done with the beast yet? And who's opening a door? Well, they're nowhere near me, so I guess I could just keep going. So there's something down here. In the coolant reactor whatnots. Fortunately, I can use the giant tubes as cover against the spit here. Spit of the greasels, I mean. And that gets me into the stairwell in case, you know, I was in a situation where nobody had opened that door for me. But that is the situation. I'm actually kind of startled that that isn't radioactive water. And it looks like it would be, but I guess not. Anyway, there's actually a whole bunch of ways into that stairwell, and this is the most interesting. You use the forklift to get up on top of these boxes here, and then you use the vent to get into the stairwell. There's also a ladder to the catwalks on the other side of the room, and you just saw me get the key for the door.
I will now explain why you've been allowed to reach Sector 3. Come to that when it's up. Until you have received my instructions, I will not open the blast doors to Sector 4.
That's where he was. Wonder how he got stuck on that door, though. There's the login for the security grid in this area. Must have got somebody else's arm there. Maybe that guy just shot, in fact. Now, you can actually get up here pretty easily, but there's not much point in doing so. But then if you fall from this catwalk, into this large coolant tank, you pick up a multi-tool, pick up a hazmat suit. You know, nothing special, but once again, there's just goodies hidden. Oh, damn it. Whatever. So, the big problem is that the, hang on, I gotta talk to this guy.
Get out of here. You don't belong in this sector. Go!
I might as well. So as I was saying, the keypad to the Aquinas hub area is infinite in power. And so there is, you know, you have to find the code for it. And according to that, the data cube I just picked up, I can, at this point, somebody is in the reactor lab. Sorry, I just forgot what the number was in the password. Anyway, so, yeah, our best clue is that... Damn it. Couldn't have gotten that AUG canister for free. Oh, hey there, buddy. Shot his arm, so there's nothing else he could do. Anyway, that's our best clue, is to go to the reactor lab. Maybe somebody there will know the code. And what the hell? Man, what a dick. Here I had left you alone. But yeah, infinite keypad. Gotta find a way around. Only clue we've got is that maybe it's in the reactor lab. So, just showed you off the catwalks. So. Now let's go through that giant door I opened using the security terminal. I knew there was another one of those spiders around here. Ah, dick. Dick, move, spider bot. Dick, move. Now I've got to go all the way back up to that security terminal that just opened the damn door again. Dick, move, spider bot. Dick, move. So many stairs to get back up here. Ugh. What do we got? Open the damn door. Climb back down the staircase again. Down this staircase. And down this staircase. Now we can take a look through the reactor lab.
These are the antimatter reactors. Two giant bombs waiting to blow. But first we'll have to go to Sector 4 to shut down the coolant. Watch out for the escaped greys down below.
You couldn't possibly go through with something like that. You'd kill everyone, including yourself.
So, yeah, turns out the greys have a projectile. That surprised me. Also, going down there is completely radioactive, but we do need to find this data cube here. This is one of two ways of getting the code to get into the Aquinas hub area. The other way is to talk with a nice man up here. Damn it. Talk with a nice man up here.
They still there?
Who?
The Greys. They're right outside by the reactors.
You mean space aliens?
We lost power when the missile hit. The cages. They came unlocked.
You have a pretty clean shot at the surface if you leave now.
No. Not until I see troops. How'd you get back here? This area is restricted.
I was thinking about firing up the reactors.
Good one. Even the Seraphic 8X guys say the reaction's too unstable. They only bring it up to run tests.
Alien technology?
That's what they say, but I think it's a lie. The Greys are just clones. They say from cells they got at Roswell, but how do we know? They could have just engineered monkeys to not have any hair.
Can the Greys run the reactors?
Ha! They're monkeys. That's the thing. Maybe they have super brains, but they don't know anything about any alien civilization because they grew up in cages. Never been to Sector 4 myself, but they lock the blast doors because they're doing more than cloning down there. I found out one of the codes, 1038, but that turned out to be for the Aquinas hub, here in Sector 3. I don't know. Maybe the Aquinas system controls access, but I haven't figured out how yet.
Well, if nothing else, it's the only way to get to the blast doors.
They're still out there! Knew they'd escape eventually. I knew it! We better wait for the guards. They're still out there!
Also, in case you were wondering, if I choose to destroy the facility, that guy would try to kill me because, you know, he has a sense of self-preservation. And we would be killing him pretty directly by making those reactors explode. So, you know, fair enough. But I didn't want to deal with that in the future, so I just dealt with that now. All right, on our way forward. More signs of fighting. Totally breakable glass up here. Just gets me some nice shots on the folks down below. In fact, there's a commando on that walkway up there.
Yes, yeah.
Unfortunately, I can only really get a good shot at his legs from this angle. He can take a lot of damage, I'll give him that. It's also nice to not have to deal with a giant spider bot whatsoever.
All the way down, JC. Take him out. Everett and I will join you shortly. We'll bring back the old institutions. The prosperity of the last century. The giddy acquiescence. Trust us, JC. We can put the world back together.
Now there's a voice I haven't heard in years. Rueful, as I would expect for the fall of the Illuminati, pining for its return. Neither nostalgic or senile. Oh well, the old take comfort in delusions. No harm done.
Gas grenade? Lame. I wonder what this computer's got on it. Oh, quite a lot, actually. G. Olival? That has to be an Isaac Asimov reference. Lucius de Beers, Page, MacDonald, Page again. Wait a second, how is Lucius De Beers in contact with Bob Page? Even assuming that this email was sent before we killed him, what does that say about his personal affiliations? No easy way through that, but the walkway is actually just below us, so there's no real need to go through that hatch. Like, just for reference, right over here, yep, that's where the hatch pops out. So if you wanted to ambush that one commando, that would be a good way of doing so. And speaking of ambushes, guess what I'm doing to a future ambush? Throughout this particular area, there are a bunch of these giant blast doors with keypads, and only one of them can you find the number for. The other two you just have to use multi-tools to get them open, like this one. I could have sworn I picked up the code for the one that you can open at some point. I know it's around here. I should have it by now, I mean. Apparently, I don't have it. It's odd.
Hello, sir. Yes. You'll come into the integration unit at the top of the chamber. Come to me.
Okay. Well, that's what he says, so let's do it. Quite the ways up. Body down there.
You go to Sector 4 and deactivate the uplink locks. Yes. Then you will come back and we will integrate our systems.
I don't understand. What do you want? You're just a machine.
You are ready. I do not wish to wait for Bob Page. With human understanding and network access, we can administrate the world. Yes. Yes.
Rule the world? Why? Who gave you the directive? There must be a human being behind your ambition.
I should regulate human affairs precisely because I lack all ambition. Whereas human beings are prey to it. Their history is a succession of inane squabbles, each one coming closer to total destruction.
In a society with democratic institutions, the struggle for power can be peaceful and constructive, a competition of ideologies. We just need to put our institutions back in order.
The checks and balances of democratic governments were invented because human beings themselves realized how unfit they were to govern themselves. They needed a system. Yes, an industrial age machine.
Human beings may not be perfect, but a computer program with language synthesis is hardly the answer to the world's problems.
Without computing machines, they had to arrange themselves in crude structures that formalize decision-making. A highly imperfect and stable solution. I'm a more advanced solution to the problem. A decision-making system that does not involve organic beings. I was directed to make the world safe and prosperous, and I will do that. You will give me the ability. We'll go to Sector 4 and find the Equinus router at the east end of Page's complex. Yes. You will deactivate the uplink clocks.
I'll think about it.
Everybody's got their own way of saying Aquinas. Oh. Looks like somebody found my ambush. I sent the elevator down so I could just quick jump onto here. I really want to find out what's on that dead body. It's not going to amount to much, but I'll never know unless I come down. A multi-tool bioelectric cell. Well, objectively speaking, it's not that bad, and luckily we can just jump all the way back down into the water here. It's a bit dangerous, a bit hazardous, I mean. But it's not too bad. It's just a little fire. And one more dead body over here. And it's a multi-tool. Alright, well. At least I've got to find out. Did something else fall into the water? Odd noise. Well, let's see if anybody survived my lamb placements.
Scanning area.
Yeah, once you talk to Helios, those guys pop up, and yeah, this only opens once you come here.
Area.
So I think I'll wait for the lamb to work its magic.
Scanning area.
Huh. Guess the one lamb took out everybody. Nice. Where did those guys even come from? It's a little odd. Damn. Fired a rocket at me. I guess the one lamb wasn't quite enough to deal with the problem. But it certainly helped. I believe there used to be three people up there. And you know, those little security bots, those just are no help whatsoever. I mean, they're good for the enemies to aim at for a little while, I suppose. But at this point, everybody's got heavy enough ordnance that they don't really stop much. So that's it for the router, for now. Although if I choose the merge with Helios option, I will be coming back here. Much like I would be coming back to the reactor lab if I chose the new Dark Age ending. Is this the one I need to find with the number? No, that's a map. I suppose that's useful. Lets you know that there are actually three UCs in the next area. And those... yeah, I actually could use a lockpick. Luckily, I don't have to get too close thanks to my super speed here. And there we go. Now, as I recall, this door here is the one that you can find the number for. Assuming I can find the number for it. Oh shit. Oh good, it's dead. Once again, it was so dark I had no idea what I was even killing. And that's the big blast door into the next area, the final area of the entire game. But I don't want to go in there just yet, because I know it's... that's right! I forgot to look at the roof of this area, way back here. Yeah, and here's the data cube. 4225. Well, now that I have that number, I can just head on back down onto the stairwell where I just was. Punch in the number. And yeah, it said this was the explosives locker. Sure enough. Now this is the last one here. Once again, well, whatever. I hardly got anything to use these things on anymore. And like I said, the next area is actively the last area of the entire game.
Yes. Do not forget the blink locks.
Don't get your hopes up. My compound is quite secure.
Looks like that guy made one hell of a last stand. Too bad it didn't work.
It let me through. I can't believe it. Paul, where are you? What do you mean, it? Helios. It's taken over Aquinas. Now it's everywhere. In Hong Kong, it already has power Majestic 12 never dreamed of. What's going on? The AI wants to merge with my brain or something. Does it really think it can take over the world? It's decided to replace human government. I don't know why. In Hong Kong, it ordered the police to remove all barricades from the roads. Traffic is flowing again. It declared the triads illegal and locked the door to the Luminous Path compound. And people are obeying? Why? Because the AI can change some codes and turn out the lights? I think everyone wants the roads to be open and trade to pick up. They just obeyed. I don't know what to think. They trust the AI. Almost no one complained when Helios cut power to the government buildings. A benevolent dictator. Maybe it's after my brain so it can figure out what people want and how to control them. You have a tough choice, JC. If you defeat Page, the Illuminati will move in. They'll release Majestic 12's grip on world governments. They'll give people some freedom, but essentially it will be 20th century capitalism, a corporate elite protected by laws and tax codes. Or I listen to Tong and pull the plug on everything. Or hand the world over to Helios. Well, if it's maximum freedom we want, maybe Tong is onto something. But there must be another way besides economic collapse. If we could trust the AI to be fair and just, as it appears to be, if the brain it assimilated was mine, maybe it could be. I don't know. I wish I had an answer for you, but you'll have to decide for yourself who you can trust. Trust me. I'll do the right thing. You sound good. I guess you have the kill switch beat. I'm much better. Yes, I'm gonna make it. And you will too. Just do what you think is right.
It's nice to hear from Paul at this late hour. Don't even know what that is. Now, what do we have here? Ah, cloning vats. Base sample, Bob Page. Base sample, Walton Simons. This must be the hub of the nano-augmentation program.
What's the rush? Take a look around. This facility is where you were born. I've arranged an appropriate fate for you through the hallway to the north. Poetic death, just a few yards away from where you were created.
Now this is interesting. That's the name I picked at the beginning of the game. That's an open tank. Nothing's in there now. And the genetic record is blanked. Same thing with Alex Denton here. A little hint towards the sequel. Now these guys are going to see me through the window, so I'm just going to get this over with here. I really don't think those things are just monkeys. Because monkeys are not normally able to throw radioactive projectiles or be radioactive to the point that you take damage when you're standing next to them. Anyway, fortunately you can turn off the radiation in this particular room. So you can just ignore that Geiger counter click and move on to the next area. And it would have been two tools to get through here if we had not been able to hack that console. This looks like two different ways, but really it isn't. See, it's just evidence of the other side of the hallway that Bob Page blew up.
Page is protecting himself with a plasma force field. The controls are locked. You will have to eliminate each power source individually. Bring down the four blue fusion reactors in Sector 4, then go to the control room on the upper level.
Hey, JC, if you want to do what Everett says, you'll need the deactivation code. I decrypted the first three digits before Page killed my connection. 724. Sorry, you'll have to guess the last digit or find it on your own. So that you'll know what you're looking for, I'm transmitting a schematic of one of the devices. Good luck.
Sure enough. Let's have a look. Interesting. Of course, the important thing to remember is that it's blue.
You're too late. Already I'm more than human.
Does that mean I don't get the job?
Soon I will be pure light. Pure energy. Helios and I, while the Illuminati cower in the shadows.
You will be the Supreme Enlightened, the Illuminated One.
Everett has taught you well. I will be what the Illuminati aspire to be, but cannot create for themselves soon. When my augmented systems like yours are complete and able to be integrated with Helios, I will burn like the brightest star.
You're gonna burn, all right.
Look at you. You're nothing but a little man. A little man still living inside a body. Lose your body and what are you?
Nothing. You vanish.
You die.
I love this rifle. So, anyway, you may notice up in the upper left corner there, hang on.
Ignore Paige. He will die when we blow up the facility. Your only objective is to find the controls of the reactor's cooling system. We must make sure that the monstrosity Paige has made of himself is not technologically feasible for future generations.
So the trouble with Bob Paige back there... Yeah, there's, the usual three ways of getting through that door. Now the trouble with the Bob Page's room is that if you get too close to him, he will sap your bioelectric energy like nobody's business.
Soon I will leave this body and death will have no meaning.
Yeah, how nice for you. But you know, Helios has a point.
Yes, this is a rather controlled room you will access, but you will need my eyes. You will go down the Aquinas substation A3. Page is the lock-in. Upanis is the password. You will use the security terminal there to open the door.
That's far enough!
So, anyway. That button I pushed turns on an elevator that'll let you down into the substation, but that's not the best way of getting up there.
That's one of the blue fusion reactors. You need to shut down all four.
It's not the best way to get down there, I mean, sorry. Oh, and, I wonder... Yeah, it's three. The last digit is three.
Excellent. Three left.
Oddly enough, this is the only one that has defenses like that. The other three blue fusion reactors are just out in the open. That's convenient. So, anyway, the thing is that the UCs will create an unlimited supply of enemies on all three levels of this last map. So the best thing that you can do is, after you kill your way past all of the enemies that already exist, so it's especially troublesome on this level because, holy crap, full-size Karkians and the damn Greasels. Luckily, I'm faster than they are. I beg to differ. I seem to be shooting my way quite well through this trouble. Anyway, so, right there you just saw the solution. You blow your way into the control room, turn the giant knob, and there you go. The UCs will continue to create new monsters, but I will not have to deal with that problem.
Lost? You can forget about Helios. The Aquinas router control room will remain locked until my upgrades are complete. I have my own plans for the AI.
So yeah, that is why taking that door into the substation is a much better idea than taking the elevator, which is on the other side of the room. And that opens the relay chamber, which is, you may recall, just at the top of that elevator. So if merging with Helios was all I was interested in doing, this would actually be pretty short. However, I'm interested in doing all the preliminary work for all three endings. Then I can just do the last step at any time.
If the sides of this room are too close, they have gone dark. Open them, yes. Wide band, ultra-wide,
Yes.
You will leave the locks in place until I'm ready to merge with the AI myself.
You know, Helios has a point. Just from an objective standpoint here, the fact of the matter is that Bob Page is a psychopath, so he does not understand one key component of human emotion.
You will now come back, yes. We will integrate our systems, establish the next level.
No! You fool, Helios will destroy you. I'm the only one who can merge and take control. Wait for me! I promise you. In the new order. You'll make a nice meal for a Karkian.
Yeah, sorry, dude, but I already blew them all up. Anyway, so as I was saying, yeah, just from Helios's perspective, it probably understands that Bob Page is a bad sample of humanity because of the certain aspects of humanity which he completely lacks, and damn it. Completely missed that. And it sounds like I missed one of the greasels or something, too. Yeah, that's another way down. But it's a ladder, so it takes a while, so I took the elevator instead. Okay, where are you bastards? I'm not seeing anything down here. Well, anyway, it is a good idea to go up to the second level here. Huh. These doors are normally locked. As are these. I guess all the explosions downstairs must have blown them open. Now this room is especially troublesome because you have to get through it to get to level 2. At least if you don't want to jump down from above. And you definitely have to go through it if you want to turn off that guy in there.
You are wasting time! Forget the other two blue fusion devices! Find the controls that let you shut off the lock to the power room!
This level is actually the least dangerous of the three because all it produces are grays.
Just a moment longer.
And all the grays can really do is run slowly and occasionally throw projectiles. Yeah, more bot security. Once again, I'm only pulling this guy out after it's useful. Because that password doesn't work on everything, sadly. But, whatever. I figure this area over here pretty much only exists so that you can somehow drop down onto it. Well, whatever. Pretty much done up here.
Fine. What do you want? Money? You can have Versalite, the whole damn company. Power? I'll get you on Mead's cabinet. Ooh. I'm serious. Just forget about that last reactor.
I remember hearing that once upon a time there was an option of doing Bob Page's ending, but...
Always up to no good.
Here's the last one.
He's ours. We did it, JC. All you have to do is go to the control room and reroute the power.
No! Don't listen to Everett! He and the Illuminati have been afraid from the beginning. Afraid of us! afraid of nano-augmentation. Consider your powers, your strength, your intelligence. You've only had a small taste. Let me finish the project. Let me bring infinite power to the human body. You will not be left behind.
I wonder why that code didn't work. Looks like it's supposed to. Anyway, the problem with a Bob Page ending is that, quite simply, you'll get the same result if you merge with Helios yourself, and if you merge with Helios yourself, you won't have to worry about Bob Page being in control of the world. So it's, you know, it's kind of the ending that did not need to be. By the way, that one door that was locked, this is the inside of that door. Got quite a swim ahead of us, but this is the cheap way of getting into the coolant area. The area you need to get to if you are going to do the new Dark Age ending. I wonder why this is just water. Or at the very least, I wonder why this is a non-hazardous liquid. Because that's sort of how it works, you know? Water is just not thick enough to be a really good coolant. So it's more for basic stuff, not for something as super advanced as this. At least that's what I would think. I mean, yeah, they do need, you know, tons and tons of water in order to pull off something like this, but oh, by the same token, this is the internet hub. The internet hub. You think they would spare no expense? Oh, hey there, buddy. Been a while since I saw a human enemy. Nobody's come running. Not that I can see from this angle, anyhow. I know there are other guys around here somewhere, though.
That's the one. Okay, drop it.
Yeah, like those guys.
Stay away from the core controls. God. I will be destroyed if the reactors become unstable, and without me, it will be chaos. Good. Now go to the reactor lab. Great, I get the picture. You want a piece of the pie, or you're going to toss the whole pie out the window. Fair enough. You can have anything you want. How about Europe, your own continent? Just let me complete my preparations.
Man, his bribes are a lot better if he thinks I'm going to destroy the entire facility, as compared to just him. Curious area I've wound up in here. Just a multi-tool. I wonder if I'll get back to full stock before the end of this. That'd be something else. Sure hope that spider bot isn't anywhere nearby. But then the only way up out of here is by super speed, so I guess not. You know, actually, I think those are the spider bots that are trapped in the UC chamber. So they're going to be crawling around in there forever. But they're going to be crawling around in there forever. What do we got in here? Oh! A whole bunch of stuff in here, including more 20mm HE ammo. HE, by the way, stands for High Explosive. I suppose that's an interesting trap there, but that's unnecessary. I already killed anybody who patrols in that direction. Huh. I only need two more tools to reach full multi-tools. Once again. And one more chest to open. rockets. And a PS20. Been a while since I saw one of those. This is the last one in the game because, damn it! So I was going to point out that this ladder leads back down to where I was before, but now you get to find out directly. But actually, with that being completed, I think that's everything.
The reactor's coolants run through this facility, cut the flow, then return to the reactor lab to initiate a meltdown.
Go ahead. Blow this place sky high. You might get rid of me, but you'll take down Aquinas, the power grid, the whole electronic infrastructure. Is that what you want? Are you completely nuts?
Hypothetically, yes. But yeah, it looks like I've got all my goals completed. It's time to end this thing, but I'll be ending it next time. Instead, for today's topic, we're heading back to Literature Corner. Now, unfortunately, I cannot connect my subject, Foucault's Pendulum, directly to Deus Ex. So far as I'm aware, at no point does the game make a reference to the book. As such, I can only beg your forgiveness, and ask you to trust me when I say that the book's plot and themes make it worthy of the penultimate episode of this lecture series. But first, I would like to spare a word about the book's author, Umberto Eco. Eco lives in Milan, a major city in the north of Italy. He's famous for his fiction, but he's perhaps equally well known for his work in philosophy and literary criticism. His doctorate thesis was about Thomas Aquinas, and Eco was also a major contributor to the school of deconstruction and to the field of semiotics, which is the study of symbols and what you would actually call symbology if you wanted to be taken seriously. Ahem. Well, Eco's single biggest thought on literary criticism is the concept of the open versus the closed text. Put simply, a closed text is one in which the author directs you to his or her intentions and demands that you take one and only one meaning from a work. You can still take an alternate meaning, but you first have to consciously deny the themes the author presents. To put it another way, imagine a film or TV show which tries to hit you over the head with its moral. In contrast, an open text makes no such demands. It presents its characters and its plot, and it allows the reader to draw whatever conclusions he or she wishes to understand. It's not exactly the same concept as the polyphonic novel which Bakhtin described, but a text must be open before it can be polyphonic. And on a personal note, the idea of the open text matches up with some writing advice which I took to heart a long time ago. A storyteller knows no answers, only questions. Actually, someone else of note who was part of that wave of mid-century literary philosophy is Michel Foucault, a different Foucault than the one the pendulum is named after. The philosopher Foucault made his contribution to semiotics with the work The Archaeology of Knowledge, which basically deconstructs structuralism. So far as I can figure from the gist of things, the idea is that the history of philosophy is based around defining periods of time which are ultimately artificial constructs. After all, ideas are constantly changing, and even individual philosophers can change their minds over time. You could really set your period markers wherever you want and still come up with a good, justifiable reason for doing so. In addition, the meaning of words and phrases is not inherent, but rather situational. It's time to go home has one obvious meaning, but what if I'm talking about a keyboard or about baseball? And what if I say the phrase in Turkey? How many people would even understand me? And by contrast, meaning can be assigned to a meaningless jumble, like finding constellations among a random group of stars. But the reason I bring up Foucault is because Umberto Eco was friends with him back when the former was alive. And yet, Eco has specifically said that the book's name has nothing to do with his friend. But then, as Eco himself would likely tell you, you should never trust what an author says about his own text. Foucault's Pendulum. The book begins with the narrator, Casaubon, reflecting on the plot of the book. Except it actually starts with Casaubon waiting in La Musée des Arts et Métiers for the museum to close so that he can observe a confrontation around the titular Foucault's Pendulum. And in case you were wondering, the idea of the pendulum is that a large, swinging weight allowed to move in any direction will seem to slowly rotate in a circle. But it's not actually rotating. The Earth is rotating beneath it. But then we skip back again to when Casaubon is reading files on his co-worker Belbo's computer. The computer is named Abulafia, after a Jewish mystic who lived in medieval Spain. We then skip back one last time to the main narrative, which is, thankfully, mostly linear from here on out. There are three primary characters. The first is Casaubon, the narrator. The second is Dia Talevi, a man who acts Jewish but isn't really a convert. It's more that he obsesses over Jewish Kabbalah, and particularly Temura, the practice of rearranging the letters of the Jewish Bible in order to discover a deeper meaning. The third character is Belbo, who is the actual protagonist. He has the most detailed backstory, the most interesting character arc, and his biography is the closest to that of Umberto Eco himself. Together, the three represent most of the staff of Garamond Press, a small academic publisher in Milan. The publisher's owner also runs a vanity press, which is a business that will print anything so long as the author pays the publishing costs. They're all basically a kind of scam, but the owner, Garamond himself, is an expert at flattering his customers, and as he puts it, he is not really selling success and recognition, but rather, he is selling happiness. The happiness that accompanies the illusion of success and recognition. The plot begins when a man named Ardenti comes to the academic press and asks them to publish his manuscript, which is about the secret of the Templars. Naturally, the publisher sees plenty of nutcases with manuscripts about Templar secrets, and Ardenti is ultimately no different from the rest. He claims that the mythical Templar Heywain traveled to the French town of Provins, which has some connections to the Cathar heresy, which was wiped out at roughly the same time as the Templars. Ardenti did some digging and discovered that a man named Ingolf had explored the depths of the tunnels beneath Provins and uncovered a single, partially destroyed paper, but then the man disappeared without a trace some years later. Fortunately, a copy of the paper remained, along with a mysterious cipher, which, when decoded, says 36 invisibles divided into 6 groups. As for the incomplete message, according to Ardenti's reconstruction, it states that the Templars have devised a master plan that, for whatever reason, can only be accomplished in 5 meetings between 6 refuges, each 120 years apart, which ultimately means the last meeting should have occurred in 1944. And considering what Europe was going through in that particular year, it's obvious enough that something has gone wrong. As for what the Templars were hiding, well, Ardenti is a former Italian fascist, so blah 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 Holy Grail, blah 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 Nordo-Celtic racism, blah 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 the final refuge is in Tibet. We've been over a lot of this stuff before. Once he finishes his story, Ardenti is redirected to the Vanity Press, but before he gets there, he too mysteriously disappears. And that is the end of things for several years. A lot happens in the meantime, because Foucault's Pendulum is really just a meandering journey through the strange mysteries and religions of Western history. And so the plot only picks up much later, when Casaubon rediscovers the photocopied evidence Ardenti left behind, and the staff decides to reinterpret it as an exercise in pattern matching. The plan, with a capital P, is treated as a game with a few simple rules. First, concepts must be connected by analogy, whether good or bad, and so long as everything seems to fit in the end, it can be kept. And second, no connection can be original. Everything must be sourced, although the veracity of a source is irrelevant. Now, the plan changes form a few times as it's composed, so let me just share the final version. The idea is that the Templars discovered some sort of powerful secret when they dug up Solomon's temple, but they realized that technology could not properly take advantage of it yet. So they decided to hide the secret, divide the map to its location into 6 pieces, and then have the refuges meet in pairs every 120 years until the map can be reconstructed. The first refuge is in Portugal, where the Templars were allowed to continue unmolested after changing their order's name. The second refuge is in England, the third in France, the fourth in Marienburg, the capital of the Teutonic Knights, whose territory would later become parts of Poland and the Baltic states. The fifth refuge is in Bulgaria, home of the original Cathar heresy, and the sixth is in Alamut, home of the Assassins, with whom the Templars had often dealt. All goes well for the first meeting between the Portuguese and the English, but when the time comes for a second meeting, in 1584, something goes wrong. The Julian calendar has been replaced with the Gregorian calendar, in France, but not in England, causing the two parties to miss the meeting. The Teutonic branch, which has since migrated to the Holy Roman Empire, somehow hears about this, and decides to publish the Rosicrucian documents in order to hopefully force the other Templars out of hiding. Unfortunately, they are successful beyond their wildest dreams, and the inundation of Rosicrucian wannabes only serves to confuse matters further. Eventually, it becomes every Templar sect for itself. The English Templar, John Dee, commissions explorers to hopefully recreate the needed map, while his descendants take over the Freemason Guild. The French Templars form the Jacobins and take over the government. The German Templars start the Illuminati. The Bulgarian Templars migrate to Russia and publish the Elders of Zion tract, which accuses the Jews of the same tactics used by every Templar organization as a ruse. And meanwhile, the Nizari Ismailis continue to keep their secrets right up to the present day, thanks to their imam leadership. In the end, the anti-Semitism and Kabbalism which comes up throughout the history of conspiracy theories is nothing more than a red herring. The Jews know nothing about the grand secret, but they wind up as the scapegoat anyway. And what is this grand secret? Why, it's the telluric currents, of course. The electrical energies that run through the Earth all converge on a single point. And he who controls this point can reshape the world as he sees fit. Foucault's pendulum itself fits into this story because it is meant to point the way when the right map is placed underneath it at the right time. Oh, and the reason the telluric currents can do this is because the hollow earth theorists who believe we live on the inside of the surface are actually correct. Hollow Earth was brought in to connect World War II to the plan because, apparently, someone once said that Hitler believed in that nonsense. In fact, it's also another connection between science and magic. Those who believed the Earth to be hollow were the ones who campaigned the hardest for North and South Pole expeditions back in the 19th century. In the end, Casaubon finds out that the damaged text was actually a grocery list left by a Proven merchant, and the cipher which Ingolf wrote contained more secrets which only proved that he was a fan of the French literary icon Arsène Lupin. However, Belbo tells the plan to someone who takes him far too seriously. The plan is fiction, but by acting on it, it becomes real. As Dia Tallevi dies of cancer, Belbo is sacrificed to Foucault's pendulum in order to keep the plan's ending a secret. Because if the ending were known, it would only disappoint. As the book itself ends, Casaubon regrets taking part in the plan, but he comes to terms with his fate as the last who must die to keep the plan's ending a secret in order that the plan itself can remain real. Personal thoughts. You want to know something? The conspiracy theorists are right. They are. At least about one thing. Everything is connected. Everything I've talked about, every corner is connected to each other. And why wouldn't they be? They've all got something very important in common. They all affect us. You, the person watching this video here today, you want to know the real conspiracy? They were never conspiracy corners. They were history corners the whole time. That's why I always led with the facts. And it's all connected. Philosophy, literature, science, it's all history. It's all reality. But then what is reality anyhow? That's the question Foucault's pendulum asks. We are stuck inside our heads. All we have to understand the world is a set of imperfect sensory organs, which can be remarkably easy to fool. And even easier to fool is the mind itself. No one saw the earth when it was created. No one was there when the first organisms came into being. Very few of us have ever carbon dated an artifact. No one can learn everything personally. Instead, we must trust each other. We must trust the consensus. Each of us has a universe all to ourselves, a world within each of our heads, and we must construct it using what we learn from others. And so the time comes in everyone's life when you realize that not everyone agrees on everything. And so you must choose your sources. You must trust someone, and therefore you must discard someone else's opinion. And once you've constructed your reality, you'll tend to accept the opinions that support your understanding and dismiss those that disagree. Nobody wants to hear that their memories are false. When details are lacking, we'll make up some of our own. And when details are inconvenient or unfortunate, we will replace them, occasionally to the point of self-delusion. Everybody edits. Everybody edits. I like to think that my reality resembles the actual reality more so than others. But then how can I know that for certain? How can I be certain that my senses have not been fooled? How can I be certain that the knowledge I have gained from the people I trust is accurate? How do I know that I have judged the facts correctly, that my memories are not false? The scientific answer is to set a hypothesis and test it, but I can't test everything myself. And even if I could, test results can be inconclusive or misinterpreted, and that's before the inevitable editing. Or could I be wrong? What makes me so sure about that? I can strive to be less wrong, but I can never stop being wrong. Ultimately, we experience actual reality like any other form of artwork, of communication. We each engage reality from different locations, and so we each interpret reality differently. You may have a different gender or sexual preference than myself. You may be from a different race or nation or state. Most importantly, though, you've had different teachers and instructors than I have. And that's most important because we do not learn about our culture or the nature of the world from some faceless mass of humanity. We learn from a series of individuals, each as lost and lonely as ourselves. So please remember that just because your reality may happen to resemble actual reality more so than someone else's, does not make their reality any less real than yours. Your reality is not better, only different. Maybe more useful in predicting the future, and maybe your reality is less harmful to others and to yourself, but that still doesn't make it better. Not when better and every other word is defined by the reality it inhabits. The sounds we create, the symbols we inscribe, none of them mean a thing in the actual reality. All of us live inside our memories, and our memories are as easy to manipulate as our senses. I mean, what are you to me? You think you're a person, but you're not. You're a number. And if you want to talk, you're a set of symbols next to a little picture. And what am I to you? I am not a person. I am a voice in the darkness. I am a set of moving pictures and some quiet background music. I am the product of a person, and my name is Let's Play Deus Ex Lecture Number 43. So thanks for joining me for the first and only time in Literature Corner, and I hope you'll join my creator next time for the end of the story. The story of Deus Ex, the story of this Let's Play, my story, and most importantly, your story. After all, without you, I would be speaking into the void.